Another afternoon reviewing stuff and... Robo Bobcat?
Salutations, comrade.
Did you do all this?
As you can see, I felt the room needed some additional memorabilia. It looked a little too dull, as you put it.
Must say, it's cozy, it's rustic. I'm impressed! This looks great!
It's not finished, but it is a start so far.
We can worry about the other walls later. For now, happy sleep time for you!
Oh, goody.
You really thought I was gonna let a useful character like that go to waste. On this zero-budget show? Hell no! When Moonbeam Entertainment was established, Charles Band wanted to stray away from one particular kind of movie. The lookalikes. Common terminology today would be mockbusters, clones, and ripoffs, because they are. In an ongoing, continuous thing that sadly is going on today, if one major thing was a big hit, another studio would jump on to get a piece of the action and claim a bit of their success onto it too. For example, when something like this would come out...
God, I love being a turtle!
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
You'd be pretty certain that eventually audiences would end up getting... this.
Stupid rule! Stupid rule!
And such is the case of today's movie, which falls into a similar trap. Because once this was a big hit...
Home Alone, Home Alone, you trick them every way. Oh, what fun it is to see two burglars get far away.
The response to that would be this. Remote is one of the more interesting movies in the Moonbeam catalog. Unlike the others, there's not a whole lot of science fiction or fantasy that's involved here. It's
certainly tries to be a straightforward family comedy without being too high concept. In the directing chair this time is Ted Nicolau, switching from his noble B-movie horror to family comedy. And given how much I enjoyed Ted's work, there is good promise here. Screenplay duty is credited to actor Mike Farrow, who strangely likes to go by one of his character's names, Tommy Sledge. While there's not too much to his credit, the only interesting thing in his filmography was working prior on the cult classic
The Lobster Man from Mars.
It's the greatest movie I've ever seen in my life.
Coming to invade soon.
Either way, it was the second film in the Moonbeam Entertainment roster, and it kind of shows they were still testing the waters to see what kind of family-friendly affair they were intended to create. Does it hold up? Let's examine some.
The movie centers around a teenage tech whiz named Randy Mason, played by child actor Chris Carrera. His quirks include hanging around with outsiders that feel like they belong in Nickelodeon's All That, messing with sport jacket bullies that would later end up on Entourage, and playing with remote-controlled cars in unsold housing property.
And this is one of the biggest flaws in the movie. While it does follow the basic formula of a three-act story structure, it tries to... Great snakes! You don't know what the formula for a three-act story structure is? Well now, allow me to elaborate! And use this movie as a prime example.
In a three-act structure film, it is broken down by three basic elements. Introduction of characters and environment, introduction of conflict, and resolution of said conflict. In the first act of Remote, the basic setup is there. Randy is presented as an average kid that has interesting things, but something feels off. He has cool friends, is a pro at controlling toys, and even his parents, while possible workaholics, are perfect.
How was school today?
Okay.
Did your dad get up all right?
Yeah.
Any messages?
Nope.
Randy, you are definitely the strong silent type. And if anyone ever tries to say you're not, just don't say anything.
In fact, it feels too perfect. And granted, it's fine to have parents that care for their kid and a son who's in control of his own universe, but that's just it. Nothing's at risk, and nothing feels concerning or threatening.
Though no one was injured in what is being described as a bungled robbery attempt, police warn that the three should be considered armed and dangerous.
Except for the looming sword of exposition Damocles, which will probably come into effect in Act 2, but usually in the basic sense of the three-act story structure, there is some hint of conflict in the first act, but here, things just seem okay. There's no real threat at risk, nothing is foreboding, everything is just fine.
Take this moment when Ben, the bully across the street, decides to litter his lawn. In response, Randy decides to do the ultimate comeback, a universal remote pranking!
2 weeks.
Our sermon today, brothers and sisters, is a story.
Cut it out, Mason!
In response, Ben decides to take one of his model airplanes under the threat that he will burn it if he doesn't allow him to do so. Randy reluctantly lends him the plane, and Ben decides to take the toy for a spin during school hours. Again, nothing feels at pure risk. The bully never uses this for a prank or means to crash and destroy it. He just flies the thing in the air and enjoys himself. But script needs a conflict. So Randy decides to mess with Ben's flight in the middle of his science class! Wait, what?
What the? Mr. Mason, need your attention!
I understand him trying to mess with this guy. I do. I really do. But couldn't he not do this right in the middle of his best friend's science project presentation?
On top of that, Randy's universal remote meddling causes the model plane to dive into his classroom and cause panic.
Excuse me! I'm going to explode!
As a result, Randy is expelled from school, and Mom is not too pleased to hear the news.
The school called. I understand you crashed a plane into Jamal's science project. When I get home, young man, I'm going to confiscate every model in the house.
Now, if Ben was using the toy plane to dive bomb into the classroom and set it up to make it look as if that it was Randy's fault, that would make more sense. Nope. Instead, our main character decided to enact upon the situation, thus putting him in the position that he's in. As mentioned before, this whole first act so far. No risk, no conflict, nothing in dire consequence. Everything was doing just fine. Why did this have to happen, you ask? Because script said so.
On a side note, the performances here are kind of hit and miss. The tone of Remote tries to be akin to a living cartoon, given how key scenes have characters providing big reactions to certain moments. Other times, some people don't quite find the middle ground. Some overact, and others feel dull. The only two that sort of find that balance is Chris Carrera and Jessica Bowman, who plays Randy's other friend, Judy.
Huh? Oh! Oh, no, not you, Judy. The Judy in this movie played by Jessica Bowman. Funny enough, though, she would later move on to other things like Joyride and take a part in the Dr. Quinn Medicine Woman series. Full Moon Entertainment had a pretty interesting way of catching on actors just right before they turn into big celebrities. It's kind of interesting when you think about it that way.
With the looming threat of Randy's toys being taken away, he decides to hide them all in their hideaway. An unsold home. Fun fact, the set scene here was only partially built for exteriors, leaving people passing by to think it was a real house for sale. They were convinced, until they were guided around the back to see it was nothing more but a set.
I hate how fake Hollywood is.
As Judy leaves for a convenient baseball game, our character enters the second act in the form of three convenience store robbers. And yes, this is where the Home Alone aspect of the movie kicks in. As well as one of the saving graces of this flick, but I'll get to that. Enter Delbert, Lewis, and Richie. Three robbers are hiding after one of their robberies goes wrong. It's said they attempted to rob a convenience store, took stuff, but left the money behind on accident. Okay, I'm not a criminal expert, but failing to steal the dough should at least be some form of positivity.
And while there is conflict here, nothing feels at pure risk or consequence. And granted, these guys should provide that, but not when they're seen as pure boneheads. I did not want to do this, but it leaves me no choice. To compare, in Home Alone, you had the wet bandits who were dim, but a pure challenge. Yeah, at times it can be easy to fool, but still be presented as a pure threat. Even their moments of falling for Kevin's traps, they still show a sense of menace, and they weren't that stupid.
I'll do exactly what he did to us, and I'll burn his head with a blowtorch.
And smash his face with an iron!
And to push the boat even further, you had the Fratellis and the Goonies, which could be menacing, but what purely holds them back is their constant bickering and family feuding, which makes them funny, but also intimidating, too. Here, our villains get the dumb part down, but there's not a whole lot to them that's menacing or provide any sense of risk. And granted, there are times where they do have some villainous feel to them, but you can't really do that when most of the time you're just a bunch of bumbling stooges.
How long we got to hole up here?
I don't know. Till the cops give up on the roadblocks. 3-4 days, maybe.
3 or 4 days? You know, I wish I never met you, Del.
Hey, moron, the feeling's mutual. If you hadn't left the money at the comic book rack, we would have been rich by now.
It was a new issue of D-Man. I was just checking it out.
We were robbing the store. You could have stole it.
These guys truly give Jasper and Horace a run for their money.
And granted, Randy being trapped in the attic does offer a possible dilemma, but there are moments when he could easily get away, despite the movie telling me otherwise. Yeah, I know it sounds kind of cowardly to escape while the three are in the home, but look at it this way. If he escapes, he's got the possibility of just going straight to the police and telling where the guys are. Instead, he decides to just remain up quietly, silently in the tip-top, and decides to just mess with the three.
Ah! Oh! Attack! What is this, your idea of a joke?
No, you were right the first time, that's attack.
Where's your dignity? There it is.
Though, to be fair, there is one moment where he actually does try to get the attention of a passerby, but, script says, we gotta have a convenient remote radius in order for that to not go so well. Now, I did mention the three robbers are a bit of a saving grace, and it's in regards to the performances. Tony Longo and Stuart Fracken reprise the roles from Pre-Hysteria, and honestly, they get the better laughs of the movie. Every time they interact, there's a good sense of timing and chemistry. Even if their lines are, well, written kind of weak.
You want some of this gourmet blend French apricot mocha stuff?
No, just hot cocoa for me, please, Rich.
You got it. This one's for Dell.
Richie, you kill me.
No wonder Ted Nicolau ported them right over from Pre-Hysteria, as he enjoyed the comedic work they did in that movie.
But what makes it more weirder is that their characters here share the same names as their other counterparts in Pre-Hysteria, Lewis and Richie. And strangely enough, they provide the same will of chemistry and comedic energy that they did in that dino flick. So it just leaves me to wonder, are they purposely the same characters from that movie and carried over into here? Or is this some kind of in-universe joke that was just thrown in by the sake of the filmmakers? I mean, Charles Band did want his full moon movies to have some kind of shared universe thingy, given how he viewed them just like comic books. If that's the case, how does that explain the demonic toys comic books seen in Pre-Hysteria 2? Does that mean those movies exist in the same universe as the movie entertainment films? Or were they...
Get the power of an extra engine. Outlaw. The first radio-controlled truck with the power boost engine. For extra speed and power. 50% more power. So when the going gets tough, Outlaw gets tougher. No matter what you run into, you'll be ready. Because this extra engine gives you 50% more power. Outlaw with power boost engine from Tyco. Batteries not included.
Down with Zelda from the very start. I got the heart and smarts to play the part.
Down with Zelda.
Creeping through with an overhead view. Cause a man's gotta do what a man's gotta do. So I stay on track, collect the facts. Never cut the slack, and I always watch my back for Jax.
Down with
Zelda, yeah. Strong I stand, I'm the man with the plan. Cause the power's in my head, and the power's in my hand.
Down with
Zelda.
The Dino Hat police car from the Super Mario Brothers movie. When these things crash, they really go to pieces. And with the suction cup bungee cord, every crash can be a cliffhanger. If only Blue Light was so exciting. It's also got a giant scoop for putting those scummy goomas in the backseat slammer, which is where they go. The Super Mario Brothers Dino Hat police car from Ertl.
This summer reminder is brought to you by Pepsi. Better get yours before Shaq gets it all.
Shaq attack! Shaq attack!
I swear on my life, I will never question that again. Thanks, Judester. You have no idea how small things like that can easily get to me. Or break me in some cases. Anyway, moving along!
The biggest difference is that instead of having Stephen Lee for a boss, it's psychotic character actor John Dell. Now, this guy is really good at playing delinquents, and I'm glad he's not frequently typecast in these roles too often.
Man, my own flesh, I don't know better!
He plays the leader of the trio Delbert, and really tries to be the brains of the group.
Open the garage door and bring the van in.
You want me to close the door after?
Yeah, I want you to close the door after. Jesus, do I have to spell everything out for you guys?
And while John does a really good job playing up the villainous nature of his character, it's perhaps too well. So much that it almost off-balances the comedic tone of the movie. And yeah, it's nice to have a pure threat in your story, but this guy has played up way too menacing.
Police have identified one of the suspects as Delbert McCoy of Pacoima.
Delbert? Here I've been thinking the whole time that you was named after Del Shannon, the rock and roll star, but no, you what?
My name's Del. It's Del. Don't ever call me Bert.
So the robbers have no choice but to hide undercover due to police roadblocks. Because bungling a convenience store robbery, I guess, warrants it. They try to get past the security sensors in certain areas by means of cigarette packages, but at least the house surprisingly works to their advantage. I could ask why have the water and gas be turned on when the house is not yet sold, but given I don't know how housing agencies work, I'll leave that plot hole open for you to debate about.
The whole joint's fake. Waterworks!
Unfortunately, for some reason, it tastes like Hawaiian punch.
And lo, when in deep hunger, the scuffy Culkin will use his toys to forge food from the bad guys. Let's watch in pure silence as he uses his mountain climber Hitler toy to steal one of the steaks from the dollar store with bandits.
Is he doing his David Attenborough thing again?
On the contrary, as minimal as the special effects are here, the toys are one of the standout elements in this movie. From airplanes to grappling hook-bearing mountain climbers, it's kind of cool when they're put to use. Credit goes to Alchemy FX Studio for creating some of the devices, whose work span over 100 movies and TV shows, from prosthetics to silicone bodies for NCIS spinoffs, as well as costume work for Lady Gaga. The Gunther toy was sculpted by Nick Mara, and supposedly the toy was willing to walk more in the movie. However, they couldn't think of any other scenes that could allow for the device to walk, so instead it moves by grappling hook. And why they gave him a Hitler mustache, I have no idea. But at least it gives Randy a means to prank the bad guys.
Ooh, blinkies.
Hey, what's the deal here?
Oh, hey, fart!
Where does he get those wonderful toys?
Also, remember in Home Alone when the parents had pure concern of their kid?
How could we do this? We forgot him.
We didn't forget him, we just miscounted.
What kind of mother am I?
Here, we get that when the mother finds Randy is missing, but not much impact is felt. She goes through the emotion of fearing her child is missing, gets the most cartoony-looking police cops in the California district.
Best thing for you to do is stay here, by the phone. We'll keep in touch.
And that's kind of it. Most of her drama is kind of presented as an afterthought and less of a character-building element. Even when Ben and his mother check up on her, it doesn't create much issue.
Ben, have you seen Randy lately? Not since he crashed his plane into Jamal's inertia-mobile and got expelled, Mrs. Mason.
You lying to her?
I threatened to take his models away. I was so mad. Do you think I was too hard on him?
If my Ben had done what your boy did, I'd have whooped him upside the head. If he knows anything, I'll get it out of him, Marty.
And that's it. We don't see her question if her son was falsely accused or get a hint of that at all. She just sits by the phone and waits to hear if her son is discovered or still missing. And that's probably the biggest gripe I have with this film. I respect the fact that it's going for this over-the-top cartoony tone, but when it introduces a real-world element like missing children and bullying, it doesn't feel as exciting or dull. It's kind of lifeless. Because it's grasping on to this lighthearted comedy tone when it introduces a serious matter of this nature, it kind of derails the whole thing. You don't know whether to take it seriously or even laugh at it. compared to other family films that know how to balance between the two. And it's kind of a shame because our last flick was able to do that kind of thing. Not perfectly, don't get me wrong, but at least it managed to. Here, on the other hand, it tries to go for this Looney Tunes style, and it kind of goes into a roadblock when it introduces some reality. And that's fine, I don't mind a little escapism mixed in with my reality, but you gotta find the middle ground in order to let these two coexist, so that way you can have something enjoying and meaningful at the same time. Even at this point, it's making Follow That Bird look like Citizen Kane.
The final 10 minutes of Remote really amps up the Looney Tunes scale, as Randy's friend Judy goes to their hideout, thinking her friend is there, but ends up getting captured by the robbers. And this is where it gets as close to Home Alone as it can get, with impromptu booby traps by means of universal remotes. Implausible? Yeah. But at least it's not like the Home Alone sequels where some of the traps are placed way too accurately. Here, on the other hand...
Remote combat! Yeah, mess with that garage door to keep them from getting away. Banzai! Stick that stray dog in them with a T-bone steak. Ooh, take that from using a ladder when you could easily get up and use it again. Pour that bucket of flaming acne tar, which probably could do more damage than possible. Wrap up one of those baddies with lawn decor that they can just simply avoid by moving away or gutting themselves out of. Thinks I'm overhyping this up a little too much. So how about a nice Hawaiian buzz cut?
I was also the number one pitcher 3 years in a row.
Wow, she tossed his gun away at a pure 5 feet. There's no way he can get it at that short of a distance. Look at this. Even the main baddie unknowingly steps on a set of RC cars, and he just lets Randy propel him forward. Nothing is stopping you from trying to take your shoes off, or at least trying to get the model cars off your feet. That's stupid, folks.
Well, look on the bright side, Delbert. You could be in Jurassic Park. Oh, how ironic.
John Deal is dangerous to himself and others.
Well, I'll give it this much. Things wrap up quick. Cops get onto the scene, bad guys are arrested, mother forgives son. And that's it. But what do you expect from something that lacks emotional punch and basic character depth? I'd only be okay with a little escapism. You gotta make me care for the characters, man.
And that is the biggest problem I have here. The story is there, the characters are there, and the basic story structure is... right there. So, why don't we feel them? Why don't we get a sense of thrills or risk? All the key elements for a family film are there, but it lacks emotion. Now with that said, Remote is... mostly harmless. The effects on the toys are cool, some of the comedy is decent, and you can tell everyone is having a good time. On that note, I'm certain younger audiences will be okay with something like this, but older audiences would probably feel tedious given the lack of an emotional anchor in places. I can forgive this for being a Home Alone clone, but in order for your viewers to be engaged, you need to provide a sense of concern and peril in the first act. While it's a step up from Prehysteria in terms of pacing, it needed more work in the story and performances to achieve a perfectly balanced film. Though, on the bright side, at least it was better than Blank Check. Less said the better.
Speaking of which, Remote debuted a mere 2 months after the debut of Moonbeam's other film, Prehysteria. And in terms of how well it did, it just came and went. My theory is that due to the heavy buzz around Prehysteria and public interest in Jurassic Park, this one just kind of stuck out like a sore thumb. It's possible that it probably did okay in video rentals, but not the big numbers that others are hoping for. It just made its mark and got swept under the rug. Hence-wise, it's probably not well-remembered. But hey, it was Moonbeam Entertainment's second flick, and there was plenty more to come. Certainly better. Come to think of it, all this reviewing is getting me kind of peckish. I guess I might as well make myself something for dinner. Or I could order my personal robot minion to do so.
You want a request?
Robo Bobcat? I would like you to bring me a juicy steak from the Outback.
Affirmative.
The engine is starting
up. One sirloin from Australia coming up.
Wait, Australia? I meant the Outback restaurant. Cancel, cancel, cancel that order. Cancel, 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 cancel. You said it, girl. Machines. Can't live with them. Can't live without them.
It's electric!
To meet the newest member of the Little Family.
Attention, everybody.
This is Stuart.
Hello. Everyone?
Are you all nuts? He's a mouse!
From the co-director of The Lion King.
Go, Stuart!
You can't rock me. And if you can't rock me,
things. I'm your man. Come in small packages. Stuart Little.
I know that you and I got off in the wrong pod. What do you say? Want to be friends?
Talk to the butt.
Cut.
No, go past this part. In fact, never play this again.